For a thousand tongues to sing. Thank you.
Blessed love to each and every one. Give thanks to the life giver and the keeper of life, Emperor Haile Selassie I, in all good doings and same. And give thanks for Empress Menen coronated with the king. Give thanks for such father and mother of creation. Glorified priest, our worthy founder and leader, president, God and king in flesh. We give thanks to the honorable King Emmanuel Charles Edwards. Glorify the mighty prophet, Marcus Messiah Garvey, the earthquake in the whirlwind, even at this hour. Yes, I'm thankful for getting the opportunity to come in your presence once again, the Honorable Priest Isaac here with you. And this evening, we will be reasoning on the cannabis. Tonight, we will be talking about the Holy Grail. I really hope and pray that you are definitely with me this moment. I really pray that you have a moment to sup with us, because we definitely, without a doubt, I know I say it every time, but we are definitely going to elevate this evening. We want to know, you know, what is the burning of the cannabis all about? The chalice, the Holy Grail. Why is it that you smoke the marijuana? And actually, I could tell you now the moral of the story. By the time we are done this evening, we will prove that the chalice really is the device that was designed to partake and to use in the partaking of the cannabis sativa, also known as ganja and marijuana, herb, weed, and some other different things. And we will show that the chalice is the altar within the portable altar, I should say. In fact, it is the biblical censer. And we will definitely prove all of that this evening as we go into the realms. And when we utilize the word prove, it's not that we're taking some grand reward in proving anything to anyone. But of course, we know we have an audience that is very genuine and really would like the understanding. So we are approaching the subject, not in a defensive mode at all, but in a mode that we are trying our best to, you know, bring a clarity to why. Like, for example, myself would never smoke a spliff or even burn a pipe without water. And it's not because, you know, I feel I'm the dreadest of the dreadest. No, it's because of theological reasons. And that's exactly what we will be going into this evening. So obviously, from time to time, it might even appear as if somehow we have gone to some other subject area. But for sure, just remember, we are talking about the Holy Grail and we are talking about the chalice. We ain't wasting no time this evening. And of course, you know, I got to remind you, you saw it at the beginning of the program this evening. Yes, it is this weekend, not the strong end. The strong never ends. It's the week that comes to an end. No more week, you understand? So it's really this weekend from Thursday the 18th, Friday the 19th, and of course, Sunday the 21st. That is the equinox day. That is the spring equinox day. I don't think I have to go into that much detail. If you need it, you could even reverse this video and look at it from the top again and see definitely what will be in store for you. It is fully the virtual edition. Remember, the full package is $120. We have slashed that to only $100. So you could be a part of this three-day event. It's not no one lecture, you know. It's 3 days event. It's not some recording and we're, you know, showing it back to you. It's live and direct. I wonder if the people really comprehend what is going on. Thursday alone is going to make you say, well, you mean there's more? We haven't even reached up the Green Castle Hill yet, which will be the Friday morning. And then that's the morning, because, and we ain't mourning, we're celebrating. And of course, the Sunday afternoon, where we will have the herbalists with us, the historians, the Naya Bingi drumming, so many different things. Friday morning will be a little more, you know, solemn as such, subtle and, you know, quiet and meditational wise as we watch the sunrise. And that will be your first encounter amongst the megaliths, where we will be showing you, you know, exactly what stone represents what and the alignment. And you'll be following us through the paths, you know, seeing us sit on the throne. We'll be communicating with you as well. Remember, you'll be there communicating with us as well. We'll be having a grand time. You better believe that. And Sunday, it's going to be grand again. A lot of different speakers, ones speaking about the richness of the culture, the richness of the area, and the richness of Green Castle Hill. But Thursday, if you saw the previous video we did prior to the Sabbath, the meditation, the chalice talk, and I showed you what's going on there at Ras Freeman. What if I should pull up that? No, I don't want to deal with that now. I want to go straight into the subject this evening, pardon me. Now, this is somewhat to some degree, similar to a chalice talk, because it's chalice we are specifically talking about. Now, as I said before, we really take off, you know, and of course, to get your ticket for the 3-day event, you contact me, priestisaac27@gmail.com. I'm so ready to go. I'm telling you. Now, really, here's where we're going to begin. I already told you the moral of the story, so I can't break it down too much. I just got to go straight into what we're going into, and we will follow along as we go along. All right, pardon me, fella. Now, we are dealing with, let's begin in the Bible, and we are dealing with the book of Galatians. Please prepare yourself. This is going to be a nice evening. Now, I just want to highlight that scripture that speaks of the allegorical nature of the Bible. Now, it is not, in my case, me personally, it is not that I'm using this scripture to try to validate some big point or try to show you, well, the Bible, just to make a point that the Bible is allegorical. No. You see, most people that utilize the Bible, They do not see it allegorical at all in any way. It is just a flat history book, a linear history book, and that's it. Story done, with some miracles in it, a very miraculous history book. But when it comes to the substance of it and the meaning and the hidden meanings and the code and the hidden understanding, no, ain't too much of that. But yet still, the very same book highlights that. And this is seen in the book of Galatians, where it is said here, let us read from the 20th verse, thereabouts. Yes. I desire to be, no, 21st. Tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, do ye not hear the law? Question. For it is written that Abraham and his two sons had two sons, the one by the bond maid, the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bond woman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was born by the promise. Which things are an allegory? For these are the two covenants, the one from the Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar. For this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her. In fact, you know, this is me speaking now. Outside of that, you see that sort of connection made several places in the Bible. There's a part where God says he has two wives. I think one name is Elohiha and Elohoba, something of the sort. But then in the storyline, this is in Isaiah, in the storyline, he says that one is Samaria and one is Jerusalem. So these two wives, because you're thinking it's two women, but then coming down the line, the two wives is symbolic. The story of the two wives is an allegory of Jerusalem and Samaria. Very deep. One thing that is very interesting about the Christ figure, he's always speaking in parables. You never notice that? He's always speaking in parables. The prodigal son. Nothing goes up. They make up story. You know, there was this man that went away and left 3 bags of money with 3 people. Nothing goes up. So he just put that together. Now, obviously, I'm sure if you go through history, you will find some story that can align with that parable or allegory that he gave. That's what allegory is all about. So the point that the Bible is highlighting, that this ancient story of Abraham, you know, the patriarch, it's in the New Testament, but it's talking about an Old Testament story. The grandfather of Israel. The story of his two sons, his two sons and Hagar and Sarah, and that whole stuff is allegorical. Okay. Allegorical, symbolic, highly esoteric. And again, when you use the term allegorical, you are usually speaking about symbolism in the form of poetry and dance and these different things. All right. Now, again, remember we have done programs like directly, like the Bible Decoded, that lecture specifically, I think we really took the time to break down a lot of what we have here. Now, just keeping that in mind, I want to highlight a story here. Speaking of the time when the book of Moses was found. And this is in the time of Hilkiah the priest. And I might have to somewhat give a background of exactly what was going on. Let me just read the story first. Okay, where we are. We are in 2 Chronicles, yes, chapter 34. And we will begin from the 14th verse. And when they brought out the money that was brought into the house of the Lord, Hilkiah the priest found a book of the Lord, given by Moses. And Hilkiah answered and said to Shaphan, the scribe, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. And Hilkiah, delivered the book to Shaphan. Okay. And Shaphan carried the book to the king and brought the king the word back again, saying, all that was committed to thy servants, they do it. And they have gathered together the money that was found in the house of the Lord and have delivered it into the hand of the overseer and to the hand of the workmen. Then Shaphan the scribe told the king, saying, Hilkiah the priest had given me a book. And Shaphan read it before the king. And it came to pass when the king had heard the words of the law that he rent his clothes. And the king commanded Hilkiah and Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, and Abdon, the son of Micah, and Shaphan the scribe, and Ahaziah, the servant of the king's, saying, go, inquire the Lord for me and for them that are left in Israel and in Judah concerning the words of the book that is found. For great is the wrath of the Lord that is poured out upon us, because our fathers have not kept the words of the Lord to do after all that is written in this book. And Hilkiah, and they that the king had appointed went to Huldah, the prophetess, the wife of Shalom, the son of Tikvat, the son of Hasra, a keeper of the wardrobe. Now she dwelt in Jerusalem in the college, and they spake to her to that effect. And she answered them, thus saith the Lord of Israel, tell ye the man that sent you unto me, thus said the Lord. Behold, and then he can, Sister Hulda goes on to explain what the book is saying. Now, the reason why I pulled that out, and I know it may have been a little lengthy there, but that's a very important story. This story highlights a point in the history of Israel, where Israel, from the top, the king, the high priest, the scribe, and all the nobleman. Once we say nobleman, we say nobleman, as plurality as well, had found the law of Moses. So this means that they were living without the laws of Moses for a while, a good while, maybe a couple hundred years. So when they found the law of Moses, they brought it to the king. And the book of the law of Moses was read to the king. Now, hey, the book of the law of Moses, I mean, when it said it was read to the king, maybe they took hours to read it, maybe half of the day. But whatever the case was, it was read to the king. Now, after the king listened to the words coming from the book of the law of Moses, the scripture say he rent his clothes. You know, that means he was in anguish. He went into mourning stage. And he said, like, woe unto us after hearing this. And listen, because if you follow what we do, our works and our lectures, you would know we did a whole video on Hulda. Because what was happening here is that this book was saying things that they could not understand. Why then carry it to Hulda? Remember, the scribe read the book. That's the scribe. He read it. It was not in a language that they did not understand. He read it to the king, and the king listened. The high priest found the book. So between the high priest, the scribe, and the king, none of them could have explained to you properly what the book was saying. And keep in mind that it was not in a foreign language, because they understood it. They read it. The king listened and said, wow, that's what the book said. And after hearing it in a language that he could understand, he said, hey, we need to find someone to explain to us what it is saying. And I'm using that now to show again that specifically when it comes to this text that is called the Holy Canon, as the Bible we're talking about, you understand? It is not just, and it is a canon, it's like a gun. It is like a gun. Sometimes you believe it's not anybody supposed to handle it. Real thing. So it needs a serious level of comprehension dealing with it, at least from my perspective. All right. Now I'm going to show you why I believe the reason why they could not comprehend it is because the Bible is highly coded. They already understood. They understood, if we understood or comprehended what the king and the scribe comprehended, we would want somebody to decode this for us too. Not because we can read the language, but what they understood or overstood or understood was that sacred books are allegory. They knew that. They knew that. It's today we don't know that. But in that time, they would have understood that this is how we express ourselves. Let me say this again. I say this all the time. As African people, we express our history. Yes, history. Our culture in general, our heritage, our quote-unquote religion, which I would call theology, our morals, our ethics, we express all of these things in these ways. These are the ways now. I'm going to show you the ways that we express the things I just mentioned. History, theology, culture, heritage, etc. This is how we express it. We express it in song. We express it in dance. We express it in artwork. We express it in the theater. We express it in poetry. We express it in good old speak it and write it and put it in a book on the papyri, carve it on the wall. That's how we express it. And even when we write it and carve it, it's still in artistic form, an esoteric form, and symbolic form. That's our nature. That's our nature. It's only lately that we have lost that. And that has been very detrimental to us psychologically, especially in the realms of religion. Straight up. So not because they could read it word for word, they knew that they needed a shaman, they needed a guru, they needed some sort of deep person to take this law of Moses and clearly explain what they were listening to or what they were reading. Why? Because the book is allegorical. And as we go deeper, you will see why I'm carrying you through this level here, if you really want to get the point properly. Now, let us look here at the songs of Moses. This is in Deuteronomy 32. And here, Moses is basically singing, really, or giving praises and thanks to the Most High for all the blessings that he have, you know, given unto Israel. So let's start from, you know, verse 13. Can't read everything. He made him, he's speaking of Israel now, the Lord made Israel. He made him ride on high, on the high places. It's nice. I know you're watching it. You can re-watch it and all of that. But you see, if you take notes, even while I'm speaking and you look back on your notes and see where I am connecting this, because everything is connection, eh? Everything is a connection. All right. So from allegory to the kingdom, find the book of Moses to what Moses is saying here now. Connection. He made Israel to ride on the high places of the earth, that he might eat the increased of the fields, that he, and he made him to suck honey out of the rock and oil out of the flinty rock, butter of kine. Kine is like a deer or antelope or something of the sort. Butter of kine. So he's speaking now of the products or the byproducts as such that you're getting from these different animals here. So you're getting butter from the kine, butter of kine, milk of sheep. Good, you follow this? This is very important. Eh? Butter of kine, milk of sheep, with the fat of lambs. I think we understand what the fat of lambs is. And rams of the bread of Bashan, not bread, you know, flour, bread. You breed them, that's the bread of Bashan, them kind of rams there. And goats. So you have the butter of kine, the milk of the sheep with the fat of lambs. Woo! Sounds like a real barbecue session going on here. And rams of the bread of Bashan and goats. Hear this now, with the fat of kidneys of wheat, huh? With the fat of kidneys of wheat, because this is grammar here. I don't want to get into the grammar class, because I might make a few stumble here, but I think we have the fat of, you know, I got a preposition here and descriptive, you know. So we're dealing with the fat. So we back the fat again, because we saw the fat of the lambs. And if you read the scripture, really, the fat of the animal is a big part. When you sacrifice the animal, the fat and the claw and all of that is key if I'm not mistaken, the fat belongs to the priests. And even before I continue to read this, don't flip your head now. Because even in Kemet, follow me, you should make your notes with this one. Even in ancient Egypt, it says that Ra comes in the form of Apis the bull, and he eats the kidneys of the kings. Huh? Apis the bull, a bull, eh? a cattle, moo, eating kidneys. So when the king dies, the man take out the king kidneys and call the cattle as they catch it. And the cattle catch that and chew that up. Of course, that's not what happens. That is not what happens. But again, we run up into allegory. It's symbolic. There's something symbolic about the kidneys. So for the god in the form of Apis the bull, which is also the honeybee, to digest the kidneys of the king is almost like to say going to heaven. Yeah, that's the levels that it's on. So it is them levels here. Even when you read the scripture, at least that's how I look at it, for reasons like this. Again, the fat of kidneys of wheat. Okay. Maybe you would expect to hear the fat of the kidneys of, you know, a cow, or the fat of the kidneys of the ox, or the fat of the kidneys of, you know, maybe a lamb and a ram. But the fat of the kidneys of wheat. And what I'm saying, no, I'm not saying it's no contradiction. I'm saying it's poetic language. It's allegorical language. The next line proves that. The next line proves that it's allegorical language. But before we get to the next line, let us stick there for those who are literalists. Now, if it was the fat of avocado, maybe I would understand. We're talking about wheat. Wheat, the man, dry old wheat. The fat of the wheat. They do have vegetables that are considered to have fat, you know, good fat. Again, avocado. I'm not no nutritionist as such, but I don't think wheat would fit in that category. In fact, not even just fat of wheat, is fat of the kidneys of the wheat. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And the next line now. And thou didst drink the pure blood. Hold on. Although you can see it, but hold on. Now, what was the blood that Israel did drink from? You know, pray tell. Was it the blood of lambs? Was it the blood of oxen? What type of blood was it? Thou did drink the blood of the grape. Now, grape don't have no blood, but the juice that the grape makes and the fermented grape juice, which is wine, is seen specifically in religious and theological and biblical studies as the blood of the Savior. That is why it's bread and wine, because the wine is symbolic of his blood. And even when you see wine used in the Bible as if it's just a story, it's symbolic of the blood of the Messiah. Even when he turned water into wine, it is symbolic. Even when in the story of Gideon, when they're stamping on the wine press, all of that is very symbolic of the blood of the suffering Messiah. That is how the book is constructed. That's really what it is. So the blood of grapes is not blood, but it's symbolic. It's symbolic. So the fat of the kidneys of wheat obviously cannot be, because wheat ain't got kidneys to have no fat and no kidneys of no wheat. Because that is not what it is. I want you to follow me good, because if you notice these little points, key points hidden in a whole heap of misconceptions, but bring these little points out, which obviously, I mean, once you can read, man, you cannot deny what we are saying here. Now, I'm trying to show you, as we continue, that when you read the scripture, I'm telling you here, about sacrificing a lamb and sacrificing a bullock and sacrificing the he-goat and all of these different things. This is symbolic writing. I know we have seen, you know, enough movies and storybook and flying house and superbook and all of these cartoons and Bible movies, so our mind is well saturated. No matter what you think, when you say Noah's Ark, you see the same thing. Adam and Eve, you see the same thing. It just appears in your head. It's hard to scrub that stuff out. You know what I mean? You need some heavy bleach to get that out and some Ajax to get that out of your mind. So it's hard to put away that. The ancient people that this is speaking of never sacrificed no goat, never sacrificed no lamb. I am telling you this. Me telling you this. You hear me? And this is going to tell you that too. Now, maybe somewhere along the line, they started to do it. Why? Because they were reading it and they misunderstood the allegory. They read that the Apis bull eats the kidney of the king, and maybe when the king dies, they try to feed the kidney of the king to a cow, not knowing that that's not what it means, because that's how we operate today. That's what's happening today. We are the ones that read the book. We are the ones that look at the ancient writings and try to take it in its most literal form and totally miss, again, the allegorical message. You understand? So hear this now. I did a program dealing with circumcision. And even before I go to circumcision, if you notice, there are several books that are taken out of the Bible. And in some of these books, it speaks about Christ in his young age. And in his young age, when they were sacrificing the animals in the temples, the young Christ was saying, so why are they doing this? The Lord does not desire this. The Lord does not desire in the blood of goats and the blood of he-goats and rams. You understand? Now, many people will say, even Rasta and so we say this, that Christ came, you know what I mean, to stop the killing of the lamb, because you know that's what the symbol means. The lamb was sacrificed. Is the chalice I talking about there? I really hope you're with me tonight. I mean, if you're serious, you're serious. Eh? Remember, they said Christ came to, the lamb is symbolic of the suffering Messiah, you know. So the lamb was supposedly slain several times a day all over the Israel community. Kill lamb, he goats and oxen, specific time of the year and festival, and all of this bloodletting was supposed to be for the sacrifice of Christ or the sacrifice for the sins of the people, but it represents the coming Christ. So when Christ now comes as the sacrifice, after he's sacrificed, there's no more need to sacrifice the lamb and the he-goat and the bullock. You know that vibration. That is what we are taught. Good. Now, when he, the same Christ, was a little boy, he was perplexed at why they were sacrificing. Now, remember, he hasn't suffered, died, buried, and resurrected yet, you know. But from his outlook, this is not right. Why are they killing these animals? Because as I said again, when Hilkiah, the priest, and Shaphan, the scribe, found the book and they read it to the king, they read it, they understood what they read. But that's just one layer. But to understand what it means, it's another layer. And that is why we ourselves can read the book and lose the whole concept. That those of us who so believe in this, that we say that we are Hebrew Israelites, and then we go and cut off the foreskin of our penis. And I've done programs on that. And I'm saying that the cutting off of the foreskin of the penis was not a literal thing neither. It is symbolic. I did a whole program on that. You could check it out on the YouTube. I wouldn't break down the fullness of it here. But it's very symbolic. I think the name of the program was the God Mim. The God Mim, the circumcised God from Kemet. Yeah, man, very deep to understand what the symbol of the circumcised penis is. Now, I know some people vex with me for that. Eh? Oh, you don't know what you're talking about and all of these kind of madness here, but it's okay. You know, but let's read here now in the scripture. Let me show you something. Now, this is in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 30. And Moses here, we're speaking about circumcision, really. Now, just check this part. Verse 5. And the Lord thy God will bring thee into the land which thy fathers possess, and thou shalt possess it. And he will do thee good and multiply thee above thy fathers. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart. Imagine that. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart. This is not in heaven. You know. This is the Old Testament. This is not Paul talking. This is Moses talking about when we cross Jordan. Not spiritual Jordan, not no pearly gates. This is battlefield, desert business, coming out of Arabia, going into Jerusalem, business going on here. That's what Moses is talking about. And Moses say that when you reach into the land, the Lord shall circumcise your heart and the heart of your children too. So you better hide them. And you know, a physician actually told me that the heart has a something similar that can actually be pulled back and expose it. And you see, the exposure of the heart is such a nice science, because the penis head represents the heart. It's so deep. It's deep when you understand the allegorical meaning of it. But anyway, again, you could go and watch that video, but let's stick to this point. All right. So God is going to circumcise the children of Israel's heart when we reach into Jerusalem. Not now, you know, in the biblical time. What do you have to say about that? Well, I believe that's more symbolic. Hold on. So that's symbolic. So what is it that we do? We choose what we want to be symbolic here. So that's my point. And I agree, obviously it is symbolic. And the same thing with circumcising the other body parts. As you read the allegory, it is symbolic. Don't be going and mutilating yourself. You may say, but it helps to keep it clean. Again, that's the whole science of the circumcised God. But trust me, man. Listen, I'm not circumcised, and I think I do a very good job in keeping it clean. Now, the book of Jeremiah. Follow this. Let's just go into it quickly. Verse 21 of the 7th chapter. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, put your offerings upon your sacrifices and eat flesh. Put your burnt offerings onto your sacrifices and eat flesh. All right. For I spake not unto your fathers, nor commanded them in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt concerning burnt offerings or sacrifices. Now here it is. I mean, you can't run from this, man. He is saying, This is the Lord talking. I spake not unto them, unto your fathers, nor commanded them in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt concerning burnt offerings and sacrifices. What do you mean? But this thing commanded I them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God, and ye shall be my people. Okay. All right. Okay, interesting stuff. Now, I myself will say that there is a law for sacrifice. There is a law for burnt offerings. There is. So how is he saying he didn't speak to them concerning burnt offerings and sacrifices? Because there's a time when he say he accept it and it's sweet savor unto him. So what's going on here? Because again, you see, you smite the shepherd and the sheep shall go astray. So no more Moses. The law is gone. People start to go astray. Just look at even Rastafari. You hear from time to time I bring up specific issue or issues concerning the order. And you know, it needs to balance off. And just the other day I was talking about white and black over white and all white for the double Sabbath resurrection. Follow me good. So when the black Christ, King Emmanuel amongst us, yeah, everything standard. Several years absent. One start to debate concept now. If we don't get it together, I could imagine how it would look in a couple of hundred years. What we're reading in the Bible is 100 years after Moses, we're looking at it. When the thing really forgotten, when people think that they understand the scriptures of old. But look at here. He said, you must take a lamb without blemish and sacrifice one every morning and one every afternoon. But Ahab, we are running out of lambs. But it says that here. Yeah. Allegory. It also says the blood of grapes. It also says the fat of the kidneys of wheat. It also says that Apis the bull shall eat the kidneys of the king. It also says that the Lord shall circumcise your heart when you reach to Jerusalem. Yeah, because it also says that none of this is an allegory. So this is why he could tell Jeremiah, he didn't say, what's the phrase? Obedience is better than sacrifice. No, that's not what it says. He says, I never spoke. Come the man, read it. Don't hide. It says right here, Jeremiah 7, verse 22, for I spake not. Them is heavy words. He's trying to show Jeremiah, I don't know who tell them that. In fact, in Isaiah, he said that. In Isaiah, when they were bringing sacrifices, he said, who is it that taught you to bring this unto me? Meditate. So this here now, I spake not to your fathers. Yeah. No, commanded them. Look at there. Not unless the Bible is contradicting itself. In the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt concerning burnt offerings and sacrifices. I never speak unto them saying so. Never. Never. Who teach them to do that? That's why when the king read the thing, he flipped. He said, wow, something don't sound right. That's why when the baby Christ was going to the temple with mommy and daddy, he said, what smells up? Is killing lambs in there? Why they doing that? Look it here. Because he never spake unto them. So why they do that? Because they misunderstood the allegory. That's the point. Just like we do today. So again, one of my main points here is that in its pure form, not 100 years after, but in its pure form, the sacrifice of the lamb the sacrifice of the ox and the he-goat science is not killing of any animal and no running of no blood. It is something else. The altar and the censer is something else, because this book that many lean on for their very life is highly coded. But a lot of us overlook that. Holy Emmanuel eyes, Lassiai Ja.
Rastafari.
Well, that's a very good introduction there. Yeah, that's an introduction, my brother. Yeah, I want you to listen to this, family, while I take a next draw. And this is just a short clip coming from the lost history of cannabis. And I want you to take in the information as it comes to you, because we're going on another level. So I hope you follow what we just went through. We just proved, we just proved that the number one, that the Bible, Old Testament specifically where we were, is not only just highly symbolic, but strongly misunderstood. Even the king didn't understand it, and he understood it. These are key points. That's why I'm beating them home. You understand? We clearly showed you that there are things in it that don't even make sense. No fat of no kidneys of wheat. Something that is not even possible. But neither is the blood of grapes. Grapes don't bleed blood. Nobody, you know, it's symbolic. The same thing of the fat and the kidneys of wheat. That is symbolic too. So who is not to say that the butter of kind is symbolic as well? Or the milk from the sheep and from the bread of Bashan? Who is not to say that is not symbolic, because they're all in the very same sentence. They're all in the same sentence. What, half of the sentence symbolic and half is literal? This is some deep stuff. But you see, yeah, we don't like, you see, something wrong with us as black people. Black people have a phobia with real leadership. They're afraid of leaders, sick. So even when they hear the truth coming, they're very afraid. But anyway, let us listen to this.
This is the forgotten past of one of the most versatile plants ever discovered. This is cannabis, a lost history. Material we have when it comes to cannabis is in the form of the Chinese Materia Medica, alleged to be written by Shen Nung in 2800 BCE. The earliest surviving copy of this book dates back to around 50 BCE. Shen Nung is a legendary figure in Chinese culture, part of a group of three kings called Celestial Emperors. Half emperor, half deity, he is said to have ruled over China long before written history, inventing irrigation, agriculture, the axe, the hoe, the plow, acupuncture, and traditional Chinese medicine in the process. He is often depicted draped in a garment of leaves and often chewing on their stems to experiment with their effects on the human body. Shen Nung was essentially the first pharmacologist. In compiling the classic of herbal medicine, Shen Nung discovered the medicinal properties of cannabis, saying it was good for gout, rheumatism, malaria, absent-mindedness, as well as about 100 other things. Prior to this, the plant, which the Chinese called ma, had been used for many centuries for its fiber in producing cloth, paper, rope, and even in the production of pottery. As the Chinese continued to explore cannabis's benefits, they found it effective in the treatment of other ailments, like vomiting and infections. It is generally believed to have been used in moxibustion practice in acupuncture, being replaced in modern times with mugwort. Around 200 AD, a physician named Hua Tuo became the first person to use anesthesia in surgery, nearly 1600 years before its discovery in the West. And while Watteau's formula for anesthesia has not survived into modern times, its name, Ma Fai Zan, translates approximately to cannabis boiling powder and is widely accepted to have had cannabis as a component, with other candidates such as jimson weed and opium proposed to be either in addition to or instead of marijuana. Cannabis was one of the 50 fundamental herbs in the traditional Chinese medicine toolkit. In modern times, with the questionable legality of its use, reference to Ma in recent translations of the Chinese medical textbooks only make reference to non-psychoactive hemp seeds. But in antiquity, the Chinese were not shy about singing cannabis's praise. Confucius compiled the Book of Odes and the Canon of Rites, detailing poetry, song, and the religious ritual practices of the Chinese shamanism of his contemporaries and ancestors. Ma is mentioned numerous times throughout each of these collections. But perhaps more interesting is its frequent association with the burial ceremony during this time period. Cannabis has been found both burned and unburned, seed, bud, and everything in between, with burned seeds having been found in Kurgan burial mounds in Siberia and China, dating back to around 3000 BCE, and nearly 2 pounds of bud being discovered in the grave of what is believed to be a royal shaman in China's Xinjiang region. But through a network of trade routes, weed quickly found its way across the ancient world, intersecting with numerous cultures in the process. As marijuana's popularity as a dietary staple, a medicine, and even the very plant from which clothing is made grew, China came to be known as the land of hemp and mulberry. Mulberries are high in protein, iron, vitamins, and minerals, just like cannabis. So it's no wonder that the two were both revered in this similar way. But while the earliest recorded history of cannabis comes from China, it is known to have been widely distributed in the fertile soil along the rivers of the ancient world. Along the banks of these great rivers, like the Yellow River in China, the Tigris and Euphrates in Mesopotamia, the Indus in India, and perhaps even the Nile in Egypt, civilization began to sprout up as well. And while it's unclear how exactly this knowledge of cannabis's medicinal and psychoactive properties spread, some evidence points to nomadic tribes emerging from the steppes of Central Asia, such as the Yamnaya, who also may have been responsible for the Kurgan burial mounds found throughout the region. Historians believe that these tribal groups of the Caucasus region helped to advance trade across Asia and Europe well before the Silk Road, spreading the wheel, horse domestication, and many other technologies of the time. Some subset of these tribes, who called themselves the Aryans, migrated from the north into what is now India, eventually merging with the people who had already inhabited the region, developing the prototypical Indo-Aryan language and culture in the process. From this culture, Indian and Iranian cultures, among many others, would ultimately be born. This proto-culture was also responsible for the invention of one of the earliest written languages Sanskrit. Some of the earliest Sanskrit texts, the Vedas, meaning knowledge, are still in existence today. These texts are the basis of our knowledge of ancient Indian history, as well as spirituality, being important religious texts for both Zoroastrian and Hindu faiths. Cannabis, or bhang, as it is called in India, is mentioned as one of five sacred plants in the fourth Veda. The Hindu god Shiva is sometimes referred to as Lord of the Bhang. There are several legends associating Shiva with cannabis, from him making it of his own flesh to help purify the Amrita, or elixir of life, to it being churned up from a sea of milk, along with the sacred cow and the moon, by Shiva himself. One such legend states that Shiva, in the midst of an argument with his family, escaped to the mountains. As he continued to climb, he became tired from his journey and the sun's hot rays. He fell asleep beneath the plant. When he awoke, he became aware of the fragrant smell of the plant and decided to taste its leaves. Rejuvenated, Shiva made this ganja his favorite food, bringing it back to humanity, along with the art of yoga, a sort of instruction manual for the practice of using this sacred herb correctly.
Talks about advertising, make sure that you get your chalice for sure. That's without a doubt. That is something that you definitely need. As you can see where we are going here this evening, yeah man, it'll be, you should be sitting and supping on your cup, and definitely that is something for you to come and partake of your natural coconut chalice, you know. A little under, this is mine here for sure. You could definitely get yours. It could be shipped to you, whether by regular mail or by the Federal Express. Even up to you, the choice is yours, depending on the shipping. But for sure, contact us, get a chalice, get one for you and the family, whether it's for the husband or for the wife, whatever the case is. And for sure, sisters, for sure, every king man would definitely love a chalice. And that's without a doubt, you can't deny that. So you don't know what to do, just contact me, man. Oh, my chalice there. That's an ancient battle axe there. That's not even this one here. That's an ancient battle axe there, man. Can't forget them, those chalices, those are old faithful that have done many, many works. Yeah, but you get your own nice and pretty and spiffy and, you know, and clean and nice. So for sure, just contact me, precise@27@gmail.com. We ship your chalice to you for sure, wherever you are in the world. You know, we just got to go around the COVID-19 thing. You know, it has its restriction. That's just the reality of it. But once you contact me and let me know where you are, we can definitely give you the details. And for sure, we could ship your chalice to you. That is, yeah, the all natural chalice for sure. The cup and the ball and of course, you know, the champ. I should have prepared the next cup while we were waiting there on the family. All right, let us continue here for now. So where we are. All right, so you got some information there. That's good knowledge for you. And remember, for sure, it's Thursday. Thursday, we are going to be doing the the marijuana education tour, the marijuana education tour and lecture. So I really hope that you can be there with us, be a part of that. It's really a historical event, and for those who are underground here in Antigua, you know that is what they call virtual tourism, the first time ever. So I'm giving thanks to all those of you internationally that have already, you know what I mean, made it your business to be a part of that event, to be with us for number one, as I said, the marijuana tour. That is something that you will definitely full joy, you know. The only thing that may be troubling you is that you can't be there to touch the plant and, and smell the plant. But hey, listen, don't feel no way. As we say, that we hope the next event that is coming up, that you could definitely come and join us right here in Antigua. But you know, the will of fire, you know, Jah will be done, eh? There's all sorts of things happening in the world, but it's just Jah will be done. But for sure, remember, again, it's a whole virtual event, so just contact me. You know how to contact me. It's priestisaac27@gmail.com. priestisaac27@gmail.com. And just say, hey, I would like to be a part of the virtual event, the virtual three-day event, you know, hike and tour and Green Castle Hill and Naya Bingi vibration and lecturing and everything else. And it's almost sad that we can't tell you eats and drinks, because you ain't going to be getting that at all. But you get your eats and drinks at home and sitting with us and bring the family together, and we shall definitely have a grand time. I'm looking forward to seeing you. Don't wait too late. Contact us early, priestisaac27@gmail.com. It's definitely going to be a grand event. As I said, only $100. Only $100. I'm talking about not the chalice, I'm talking about the ticket. Your e-ticket for your three-day event, the Spring Equinox. Yes, two hikes, the Green Castle Hill, the morning hike and the evening hike. And of course, you know for sure, the grand tour, the marijuana tour, which will be Thursday afternoon, at least Eastern Caribbean time, 1 o'clock Thursday afternoon. Good Friday morning, early in the morning, Eastern Caribbean time, like about 6 o'clock. So if it's Eastern Standard Time, unless the time has changed back by now, it's going to be like 5 o'clock in the morning. That's a good time for you to be up and joining us and ready for the experience. That will start your day mighty. And then, of course, the Sunday afternoon, which should be a little more relaxing, your day will come down nice and sweet with us as we look at the sunset there at Green Castle Hill. Listen, this is going to be such a wonderful event. Just for $100, believe me, it is worth it. Not trying to sell you nothing, yo. I'm just telling you straight up. You're serious about just keeping the vibes? That is worth the little $100. I'm telling you straight. And you don't know the works we're doing is just to cut and clear and to rise the standard of Black people. So there should be no hesitation whatsoever. Contact us, get your ticket for that event, and get your chalice one time. unless it's FedEx, Super FedEx. I don't know if you'll have it in time for Thursday. Yeah. Man, FedEx is expensive. All right, definitely give thanks for the life giver and the keeper of life. When you contact us, we can talk about that, because there are alternative ways of getting around that as well. So basically, that little history is good. I think that alone is just a boost. I don't even have to go over what was said a moment ago. So I will just continue on our levels here. Now, you see, and let me say before I go on to, this is very important, that you could definitely, our latest book, which is The Heavens Declare the Glory, please feel free to go on Amazon and type in our name, Priest Isaac, Amazon. And you'll definitely find not only The Heavens Declare the Glory, but the true biblical land of Israel and the book Anu. Very good. Now, my outlook is that the tree of life is more than just a tree. The tree of life represents a man. In fact, that's really what it is, not just my opinion. That is really what it is. The tree of life does represent a man. The tree of life represents the Christ figure, because the Christ figure is seen as a tree. Now, of course, many of you would be quite familiar with the tree of life meditational system. And the tree of life meditation system obviously has to do with meditation, different layers and levels of this meditation as well. And it's an ancient Kemetic system. The tree of life, somewhat like the word God and love, is a word that is used in many ways for many different things, sometimes misused. Several trees are given the title the tree of life, like the merengue. There's another tree in South America, the almendelio, or I can't remember. Something, it goes very high though. That's the same tree that those parrots would dwell in. The macaw parrots, beautiful parrots, they dwell in those trees. That's called the tree of life as well. But of course, you know that the marijuana, the cannabis sativa, some prefer the name cannabis sativa, pardon me, is our nomination for the tree of life. Just listening to that explanation a moment ago, we have obvious reasons why the cannabis sativa would be our candidate for the tree of life. Historically, you could see it's sound. And you know, you hear one speak of magic mushrooms. I'm not a magic mushroom person, no offense to the mushroomers. Super Mario is a magic mushroomer. You see what it does for him. But personally, that's just me. I'm not a magic mushroom person at all. Ayahuasca. From time to time, I refer to my herb as ayahuasca, really, you know, just in a sort of fun stage, because I understand the levels that ayahuasca would take you to and can have a certain level of respect for it too. Because you see, those of us who partake of the marijuana, let me just say quickly before I get to the green brother here, is that for those who may not understand the whole ayahuasca thing, ayahuasca is a brew that you would get from some of the native tribes in Southern America. It's more than South America, but for some reason, South America is the one that people somehow meditate more upon. But it's done in different places, and it's done with the specific ayahuasca tree. And I think it's an acacia, a tree and something else, and made in a specific way and brewed over a specific time. Obviously, you'd have to have the skill to deal with it. And when you approach it now, then this is important, listen to this. And when you approach this ayahuasca brew, the person would have to go through like a specific ritual even before they touch it. I think they fast for at least a day or two or something of the sort, cleanse themselves, and if they eat, they don't eat specific things, no sexual intercourse, at least 3 days coming up onto the ayahuasca. And then even after you take it, I think you take it with a tea, and you have to, you know, be in the presence of the shaman and these different things. And then days after, you actually are supposed to continue with specific rituals. Now, that's why it gets that level of respect too from I. These are psychedelic plants and psychedelic brews. Not brews, you know, brews, brews. You know, they open certain portals, as we were speaking about when we were on the program with Brother Sana today. We're talking about the different portals and what fingerprints of the gods would have said, the man that writes the book. What's his name? Fingerprints of the Graham Hancock. Yes, when he speaks about, he considers interdimensional travel to be a deliberate conscious decision to directly alter your psychological state of mind. Yeah, man, that's really what it is. And these plants, the mushroom, magic mushroom, ayahuasca, the cannabis, and certain other things in nature tend to have that ability to do all of that. Now, I ain't putting down nobody uses such it, but for sure, my personal outlook is that the cannabis, the marijuana, the tree of life is specifically made, different levels of it, for that purpose. Just what I explained, that heavenly experience and connection with the astral and the ether world. Mm-hmm. Now, that's just one aspect of it that many of us partake of and really look forward to when we use it. But why? What's the reason for all of this? Because I just explained how you approach the ayahuasca. I always meditate, if one could approach the tree of life like that. Yeah. Remember, even within the Congress order, they have times when you fast from the herb. You know, times when you fast from the herb and when you literally return to the herb. It may not even be the bong. It may not even be the highest grade. But because there has been an absence from it, it affects you on another level that you could literally see and feel and experience and well conscious of it, because of that period of absence. So there's a certain level of reverence that you give to it, approaching the ayahuasca. There's 3 days of fasting and all these different things. Then you approach it. Because smoking every day, several times a day, carrying you to where it carried you, or keep you where it keeps you, and anyone that's a seasoned smoker knows what I'm saying. But yet still, if you allow yourself to literally land, sometimes you're even in a position where you don't get a smoke for 2-3 days. I'm talking about seasoned smoker now. I know some of you out there, you can't tell me last that they pass and you didn't puff something. So when you get that 2-day break, for whatever reason, maybe you end up in the hospital or something, and you come out and you roll up your stuff and you, somehow the meditation is a bit different, because the senses got a chance to land, and you've given them an opportunity to rise again, and it's a different vibration. So I'm saying now that the ayahuasca, before you touch it, you fast from it. So the ayahuasca is some powerful stuff, eh? But the marijuana, the ganja, the cannabis is some powerful stuff too. Not overpowerful, but powerful. Powerful. I don't know what the ayahuasca do, but I can tell you personally what the cannabis has done for me, for sure. So I know it's some powerful, powerful stuff. And I think there's a level of reverence, even starting with the chalice, there's a level of reverence that is needed when we approach it, you know, in respect and the moment for it, lock everything off, quiet time and circle time. You know, it's a very serious thing. The reverence for it is like the reverence around the dinner table as well. Very, very, very important. So the Christ is the tree of life. And the tree of life is actually a man, a human being. The tree of life is not necessarily just a tree. Of course, there is a tree. The fact that you call it a tree. Now, I just explained that the tree of life is a meditational system. And can you imagine if you know the tree of life meditational system, is the author, the name of the author that wrote the book, I can't recall at all. But most of you would know him. The Tree of Life, the brother that wrote Medu-Netta as well.
Ra Nefer Aten.
I think that's it, you know. I think that is him. Ra Nefer Aten. I think you're correct. That wrote those books, the Medu-Netta and the Tree of Life. So if you were to study those books and you would understand the Tree of Life system, and then you partook of the Tree of Life. Remember what he just said in the history we listened to. He said when the god Shiva came out of the Himalaya mountains, Shiva had the Ganja in one hand and a book of yoga in the other hand. So it was a manual, and the book was given to Shiva to show mankind how to use the Ganja. So the Ganja comes with a book. The marijuana, the cannabis comes with a book of instruction of how to use it. And here was the book dealing with yoga, breathing, meditation, Tai Chi, stretching. I saw our sister Tiffany Bradshaw. I hope you have checked her channel, Sister Tiffany Bradshaw. She was with us on Mind Your Own Business, you know. Many ones don't seem to understand the importance of Mind Your Own Business. It's very important that we think business-wise. So I'm humbly asking the ones to check out them programs there. It is for the benefit of all of us if we're serious about our liberation. And she had, she put up a yoga session that you should check out. And as I said now, the cannabis sativa was in one of the hands of Shiva. And Shiva came down in the other hand. Shiva had the book of yoga, explaining how to use the ganja. How many of us that use ganja have read the book of yoga? Yeah. So all of this is deep stuff. It says that the ganja was made from the skin of Shiva. So Shiva again is seen as, you know, the whole green god, blue god business, green screen, blue screen. Because Shiva is one of the green gods. There's several green gods there. Asar, Osiris, as you see here, he's a green god. Hulk is a green god too. Lord Pakal with the green mask is a green god. The Olmec, the green god. Al-Qaeda, the green one. You know, the jolly green giant. I wouldn't need none from him. But so the point is now that the whole science of the greenness, remember that the chlorophyll, this is some key points, my family. Listen to me, this is some key points. The chlorophyll of the plant is known as the blood of the plant. Now remember the makeup of the blood of the plant, and when you connect it to the makeup of our blood, the structure of our blood, the molecular structure of our blood and that of the plant's chlorophyll. Remember the chlorophyll is referred to as the blood of the plant. The whole molecular structure is exactly the same. It's only that our blood has iron. And iron is very interesting because iron is really iron. Because this is why when our blood is exposed to the oxygen, it becomes red. It basically rusts, really. Oxidizes, really. You know? And Brother Phil Valentine, really, Elder Phil Baba Valentine, once did a lecture and I could never forget. He was speaking of why the Kemetic gods like Amun and certain gods would be seeing gold. That's Phil Valentine. And his reason for this was that within our molecular structure of our blood, we didn't have iron. We had gold. So we were seeing gold. Now, I don't know if we were symbolically seeing gold to show, even in modern times like now, that we had that gold, or it made us gold, you understand. But that was Baba Phil's Valentine's reasoning. So then gold was in the place of iron. Now we have iron here. In the plant, the blood of the plant is the same as the blood of the human being. Can you imagine that? But the human being has iron in his blood or her blood, wherein the molecular structure of the chlorophyll, the plant will have its manganese or magnesium. What it is?
Magnesium.
I think
so.
I think it's manganese though. But whatever the case is, the blood of the human being would have the iron. And just because of that one difference, you have green blood in the plant and you have red blood when oxidized in the human being. Now, this is why, again, you would see a lot of the ancient gods being seen green. It's not just Asar, but we're just using him there because it's symbolic of, again, the tree of life. Remember, the tree of life is a human being. The tree of life is not just a tree. Yes, there is a tree that is symbolic of the tree of life, the man. That is why the marijuana has been so persecuted, just like the man. The Rasta man has been so persecuted, and the Rasta woman, just like the tree. You see, like how they kind of freeing up the trees, so they kind of freeing up Rasta kind of way. They still persecute Rastafari, believe me. Even many ones that think they have somehow freed up within their mind, somewhere behind, somewhere in the top shelf, in the back room, there's some level of prejudice towards Rastafari because that's what you have been taught since you were small. Yeah, it's just reality. So just in the same way that Rastafari has been persecuted, the tree, Junior Reed have a song named That Tree. Junior Reed said all the trees of the world could be so free. So why can't they free that little tree? And it's a beautiful song too. Yeah, man, maybe we should grab that before we leave. If all the trees of the world could be free, so why can't they free that little tree? Oh my. Talk. That the cannabis has earned the title of the tree of life. Don't tell me about no moringa. Hold your con. What moringa? I don't care. None of them. Allahs, nothing can take the place of the real tree of so-called God. Yeah. Rastafari. So the tree of life, the man now. Remember, he is described in the scripture as the root of David and the stem of Jesse. And there shall be a branch coming out of Jacob, and it shall bud. You know, sound like a tree to you? That's a tree root and stem and branch. It's not an automobile. Is that true? So therein now, within that scripture and those scriptures, here you see the ancient symbol of the Messiah figure, the Charist figure. Here he is, look right there. The Amsu figure, just finding the different words, the Sahu figure, seen green, symbolic of the fact that he is representing the tree of salvation, the tree of redemption, the tree of life. And again, that is in the theological sense. But there is a tree, literal tree that you plant and grow out of the earth. That is the tree that represents that concept of the Christ man being the tree of life. And it is the cannabis. That's the point. Hence, again, the green color within the whole concept of the God figure. Good. Now, The Last Supper now. Is it following? Are we going there? The Last Supper. Oh, boy, this is something else. It is at the Last Supper where Christ and his disciples, they were, well, having the Last Supper, his last meal. You know, like they just give prisoners a last meal before they execute them. So there was this Last Supper. And at this Last Supper, they were eating the bread and they were drinking wine. And this was a ritual, a symbolic ritual. It was the Passover, a symbolic ritual. Didn't sound like they were slaying animals at this Passover here. And it was a symbolic ritual of the suffering of the Messiah. See, like we're going through Lent. Yeah, this is where we're going right now. The suffering of the Messiah. We're not doing no part two. We're done in this tonight. I just hope they can keep up. Who can't keep up? Just can't keep up. No part two. We're going straight through this. Like, it is heavy. We're dealing with our God, our Lord and Savior there. This Lenten period ain't no jokey thing. At this Last Supper, you know what he told the disciples? Anytime you eat and drink, do it in remembrance of me. It was before he was going to Golgotha to die for the sins of man, yeah, and woman. Remember, this is allegory class, eh? So don't get too led astray here. Come on, this is allegory class. So yeah, but at the same time, allegorically speaking, at the Last Supper now, you check it. And remember, we tell our history through allegory to it. So at the Last Supper, they were drinking from the cup. This cup here, not the one necessarily on the screen, but the chalice, the specific chalice. This is a chalice. This here is the chalice that is used within the Anglican Church and the Roman Catholic Church and whichever other church uses this for communion. It's called a chalice. Maybe some of you never even knew there was another chalice beside our chalice. Yeah, that's a chalice there. And this chalice here has wine inside of it. And the wine represents, of course, the blood of Christ. And in the Bible, at the Last Supper in the upper room, they had bread and they had wine. And they broke the bread, for the bread represented the body of Christ. And the wine represented the blood of Christ, which was shed for many. King Selassie. And when they sipped of the wine and ate the bread, he said, anytime you did this after now, anytime you do this, anytime you eat the bread and drink of the wine, do it in remembrance of me. You hear how you're supposed to drink that wine? I won't say no blood. You see how you're supposed to drink the wine and eat the bread? And some of you say, oh boy, Ross, we need them cannibalism thing about drink blood and eat body. Ra, as the bull, some people can't balance it. You know, the people that say that believe in the pyramids of Khufu, no joke. Eh? Ra, as the bull, eats the kidneys of the king. All of them. Holy Emmanuel, will I.
Selassie, John, Rastafari.
Them being classy. Eh? As often as you do it in remembrance of the suffering Messiah. We did a program when we, you know, came forward from that little space that we had there. When we had that experience that we talked about, and we were going into Haile Selassie,
Haile Selassie. That's the Messiah I just be talking about. Any last supper is him I dealing with, and you know, trust me, that's where I am. Haile Selassie, not Jesus Christ. Haile Selassie. I want you to be clear, you know, or I be clear. Want it to be clear. Because a lot of what you're reading as old story is what happening now. Haile Selassie. When he got his knee fractured in that taxi, man. Oh. And the king went to the BBC and tell them, hey, a lot of you at this time of the year celebrate the birth of the Messiah. But in our celebration, we tend to forget. What we tend to do? Forget the trials and tribulations that he had to pay. Haile Selassie. I don't know what. No, I know what Haile Selassie do. I know what he did. I know what he did. None of you would be around chatting or chatting if it wasn't for Haile Selassie. Yeah. I mean, during that time I talking, not no fanciful talk, and he created the world talking. I mean, during that time when Mausolini and the crew came in, if it wasn't that man there, I don't, you could, trust me, I don't know who else could have defended Ethiopia. Man, even if Menelik was there again, this was a different war at a different time. That was the chosen being that could have, you know, used his shrewd meditation to make sure Ethiopia stayed free. But you see, many ones somehow missed the heights of what happened there. And to allow independence to happen within the black communities of the planet, where black people dominate basically the black communities really of the planet, as far as nations, the African countries getting their independence. So understanding the suffering that he went through during the time of that process. And we already broke that down significantly within the 5th of May to the 5th of May, understanding the allegory of the five bleeding wounds coming to life. The 5th of May, 1936 to the 5th of May, 1941, exactly 5 years, maybe in the fifth month, the fifth day, five bleeding wounds he bear, because that is the story of Osiris. Eh? The story of Osiris is the story of the emperor, as I said already, you know, the book. That is why I highlighted the book, the Heavens Declare the Glory, Rastafari and the Cosmos, The Heavens Declare the Glory. That is our more recent book, The Heavens Declare the Glory. It's in ebook version. You should check it out on the Amazon specifically. You can contact us and get it, but you can get it on the Amazon as well. Just precise that, The Heavens Declare the Glory. And within such, we clearly explain the science of Osiris, how he's directly linked to Emperor Haile Selassie I, from the coronation and the 72 and the 16 pieces, cut into the 16 pieces and the Article 16 and 5 years in the underworld and risen exactly on the fifth year to become the constellation of Orion, to rule both North and South, the only head of state to address both League of Nations and United Nations. It's just undeniable, you know, just undeniable. So I'm just showing you, even within all of that mystics and understanding, just seeing the pain he had to bear, just as the hymn says, there is a green hill far away without a city wall where our great Lord was crucified, who lived to save us all. We may not know, this is the key point, we may not know, we cannot tell what pain he had to bear. That's it. And he said that in his speech. We tend not to meditate on the pain and trials and suffering that Christ that we celebrate, which is he talking about himself, for sure. the pain that he, Haile Selassie, had to bear for the redemption of the world. No religious redemption, real historical, geopolitical. Everybody could be smoking in Hitler's acid chambers right now. Redemption I talking about. King Emmanuel VII. Rastafari. So I'm saying now, just hold tight with me, eh? Just hold tight. We have a little more to go, man. So that whole concept now of doing the Last Supper thing in remembrance of him. This is a Lenten period. This is why we're talking this. This is the mentality you have during such a time. You're doing it in remembrance of him, the suffering Messiah. Yeah, check the vibes. Yeah, it's a real thing. Eh? It's up to you. If you don't want to take the length and suffer now, you might have to suffer another time. Them is easy suffering. Them is good suffering. I don't even know what you're talking about. We meditating on the suffering of the Black Christ himself. It's 5 years they sentenced Marcus Garvey to in tomb prison. Eh? And Poo himself. Eh? And Obese. So in the Old Testament, you talk about the lamb, the lamb without blemish, which represents the Christ, the lamb without blemish. And as you could see at the Last Supper, there was no lamb. Well, the lamb was there, but the lamb was a human being now. That's what it is. The lamb was there, but the lamb was a human being. And the lamb is about to get slain. So they should have been still slaying a lamb because he wasn't crucified yet. They should have still been keeping up. But there's nothing about the scripture that tells you that Christ was slaying no animals. And he was wondering what's going on, because he knew that was wrong. Not that the time's done for that. That is wrong. I never spoke unto your fathers when I took them out of the land of Egypt concerning sacrifice and burnt offerings. I think we cover all of that already. That's why we went through that. There's nobody that can say that we didn't clarify that what they're trying to teach us is not so, according to the same scriptures. Good. So we move on to understand where we are now. Because now the supper again, very important moment, you know, very important point. Even when it comes to the science, that holy grail then is the chalice. That holy grail is the chalice. It's not this cup here. It looks nice. Yeah. I could take a couple myself, special occasions, and you know what I mean, break my fast and all of that, but that's not the chalice. The blood of Christ as such is not the wine. And the body, I'm telling you, is not even the bread. All right. So let's return again to the understanding of what the tree of life stands for. It stands for the Christ. Remember, it stands for the Messiah. It stands for the man, the root of David, the branch of that come out of Jacob, the stem of Jesse. The man that shall blood bud and bring forth fruit. Well, blood too, because it's about blood too, because inside of the cup is his blood, and the bread supposed to be his goody that shall be given. And when you understand the science of the heavenly being, because when you tell people about God, a lot of people tell you, well, you know what I mean, God is not a human being. And the Bible says God is a spirit. And those who worship him, I say, worship who? Worship him. Him. Him is a, why not her? Well, can you say he's a spirit? They ain't got no her spirit, ain't he and her. But anyway, God is a spirit. And those that worship him shall worship him in spirit and truth. And God cannot be explained. And God is this, and everything is God. And the wind is God. And all beyond them stars is God. God too big and all of that. Okay, fair enough. But the understanding of the Messiah concept is that this, all this big thing you just mentioned here, chose a human being to pick up the flesh of somebody. He picked a lineage to plant the thing long, long time. Make sure people announce it so you'll be clear when he come. And he pick a human being and come and sit up in that human being and say, yeah, well, look, I'm here. And that same human being now, that God, as you call him, come into, go through some serious suffering just to set things in order on an earthly level. And to show how humble the God is, the God even leave the work to be continued because the God in us now, this is such a deep, deep thing. So when you partake of the sacrifice of the bread is the lamb's bread. In the Old Testament was the lamb, the New Testament is the bread. It's the lamb's bread, it's the marijuana. The marijuana represents the man, the tree of life. The tree of life is the marijuana. The tree of life is the Christ figure. The Christ figure is the lamb. The lamb is what you put on the altar and sacrifice the lamb and burn the lamb and roast the lamb on the altar. And underneath the altar, according to the Bible, there is a basin, and the basin will catch the blood of the lamb. The basin will catch the blood of the lamb. So after the sacrifice, you see all the blood of the lamb inside of the basin. That is Old Testament thing I'm talking about. The plant has its own blood. It's called chlorophyll. This is almost like reviewing what we just covered in the last 20 minutes. The plant has its own blood. It is chlorophyll, pardon me. The same makeup, just to show you. It has it's the same molecular structure as our blood, just to show you how mystic it is. Only that we have iron within our molecular makeup. So now it's basically the same thing, to the point that we see it even in theological science and esoteric science, as Osiris now, the green god, and the Lord Pakal with the green mask. And of course, other figures that I see in green, the Al-Qaeda, even the Flintstones, remember the little alien gazoo. Even aliens are green in general, because the green figure is a symbol of the God figure at a specific time. Just as Phil Valentine would say, at a specific time, the symbol of the God figure was gold. You understand? So the green figure is the man, the tree of life. That's why Osiris was cut into pieces. When you take the tree of life, the marijuana, you cut it into pieces. Yeah, you have to cut it into pieces, and then you put it and sacrifice it on the altar. You understand? Now, what I will do here, I will prove to you, and as I said, please be comfortable, because I still have a little time to go. Yeah, man, I still have a little time to go. So, hope I'm not keeping you. We got more to go. Give thanks to those who are staying with us. Blessed love. Verse 29 of the book of Isaiah chapter 30, yes. He shall have a song as in the night when a holy solemnity is kept, and gladness of heart as when one goeth with a pipe. A pipe? A pipe? Okay. Yeah? No, but Ras, it's a flute. Flute. Who says it? Well, what you think it is? Chalice? It's a faucet. Oh, come on, man. Listen. Okay.
It's a flute. So one come with a pipe, got a flute, you know, they're going to play music. Yeah, yeah, it's celebration. All right. Yeah, one come with a pipe into the mountain of the Lord, to the mighty one of Israel. And the Lord shall cause his glorious voice to be heard and shall show the lightning down of his arms with the indignation of his anger and with the flame of a devouring fire with scattering and tempests and hailstones. For through the voice of the Lord shall the Assyrians be beaten down, which smite with the rod. And in every place where the grounded staff shall pass, shall the Lord shall lay upon him, which the Lord shall lay upon him, pardon me, it shall be with tabrets and harps, and in battles of shaking shall he fight with him. Okay, listen to me good. You see that verse 32? This is my opinion here. My opinion is that that grounded staff is the same pipe. Now, if it's a flute, it can be a pipe, not unless it's, you know, but a chalice can be a grounded staff. You see how long the chalice them be in some of these old pictures? Okay, watch me good. Listen to me good, man. In every place where the grounded staff shall pass, which the Lord shall lay upon him, it shall be with tabrets, that's instruments, and harps. And in battles of shaking will he fight with it. So this grounded staff that coming with music, he shall fight with it. Verse 33 now, listen to this description here. Oh my, the last verse. For Tophet is ordained of old. Yea, for the king it is prepared. He hath made it deep and large. The pile thereof is fire and much wood. The breath of the Lord like the stream of brimstone doeth kindle it. Onion layers, huh? Onion layers. I mean, this has different layers. Tophet is a city. It's water far to make it with Tophet. Tophet days done. Little Miss Muffet sat on the Tophet. Well, I hope, well, if she down there, that's the end of her. But still, that's just one layer of the onion. There's another layer here altogether. For Tophet is ordained of old. What does Tophet mean? Tophet is a word that means the altar. Now, what I'm saying here, in this 33rd chapter, or verse, pardon me, of the 30th chapter, this 33rd verse, to me, is not only describing the grounded staff, it is describing the pipe because it's describing the chalice. What? The 33rd verse of Isaiah is describing the grounded staff that the Lord shall have in battle, that people coming with tabrets and harps when he coming through with it. Isaiah 33 is describing the pipe that a one shall come to the mountain of the Lord with a pipe. And yes, I have seen the word flute in some other versions of the Bible. We'll prove that wrong. Verse 33, for Tophet, the altar, is ordained of old. For the king it is prepared. It is made, for he had made it deep and large. Eh? Deep and large, with a bigger one. I have a bigger cutty than this. Deep and large. Now, yeah, looking over there behind the, yeah. Now, watch the vibes. What you're going to see here, deep and large, what you're going to see here, is the four elements that are inside of this in verse 33. Because the elements here are fire, wind, water, and of course the earth,
the clay, the coconut, bamboo, earth. Water is the water inside. The earth is also the herb, the earth. And at the same time, the wind is what you use to activate the fire that you put inside on top of this altar. It is the four elements that make up the chalice. And I'm showing you now, here in verse 33 are the four elements. The Tophet is the altar. It is ordained of old. Yea, for the king it is prepared. He hath made it deep and large. The pile thereof is fire. The pile thereof is fire. And much wood. The breath of the Lord, like a stream. You hear stream. Water inside. The breath is the breath of the Lord, like a stream of brimstone doeth kindling. Hold on. It's the breath of the Lord kindling this in. The Lord is the one that's kindling. You know, kindling means set a fire. And he's setting it afire by using his breath. And in the using of his breath, it is said to be like a stream. Breath and stream. The Lord kindling something here. The thing that the Lord kindling has an altar. The thing that the Lord is kindling has an altar. And it's made large and wide and deep. And inside of it is plenty fire and much wood. Yeah, and the breath of the Lord, God Almighty, is the one that light it up. The stream, the water, earth, wind, water, and fire, the chalice doeth kindle it. Holy Manuel, I, Selassie, Jah, Rastafari. We're not done, you know. Now you may say, it's not that, man. It's not that, man. You just said that the Tophet is a city and the Lord had a... And I said, yes, I get that, but it's more than one thing. That's an allegorical class, brother. Them things is sometimes seven layers, the one story have. Psalms 18 says that the Lord arose and smoke came out of his nostrils. No, that's symbolic. If it's one thing, brother. Some people know when to get symbolic. When the Lord circumcised in your heart, oh no, that's symbolic. When you're circumcising your penis, no, that's the real thing. If you say the Lord, fire came out of his mouth, well, yeah, man, the Lord bad, you know, he can do anything. Smoke came out of his nose. No, man, that's symbolic, man. Yeah. You know, I make it sound like another lie ain't smoking no spliff. So you done see the great God on the throne up in the clouds, brother, with the chalice in his hand. Mm-hmm. And all the little angels flying around, taking a whiff. Holy Marcus, I, Selassie, I, Jah, Rastafari, blessed love, man. Yeah, man, do this in remembrance of his sufferation for us, man. That's what the Lenten period is about. Thanks for fasting and praying. We don't like it, it's their business. We're soon done. We're almost there. This one hot. Thanks to those who have stayed with us to the end. No worry, I promise to make some shorter videos. People like to tell you what to do. You know, you need shorter videos. Imagine that. Hey, well, you just give yourself 10 minutes and lock off when you get 10 minutes. Now, even that 10 minutes can save your life, man. Yeah, even if it's an ad, it will save your life, I'm sure. Yeah. We don't sell salvation, but what we sell can save life.
Yeah. What we want to read here. Okay, we're coming down here now. We're going to seal up. I think this will be the last one we have here. Did I have to show you something? Oh, wow. Oh, no, I got to show you this one here. I can't leave that out. I can't leave that. I got to show you that. Let's go to Joseph first, and then we get to Melchizedek. I'm going to show you Melchizedek with his chalice. You got to, I'm telling you. I'm going to show you Melchizedek with his chalice. Okay, the book of Genesis chapter 44, you know the story of Joseph. Joseph was in, you know, sold to Egypt by his brothers. Joseph became basically almost like the king of Egypt under the Pharaoh, according to the story. I'm purposely not saying king of Kemet. I mean the king of Egypt. So Joseph became the king of Egypt, basically second only to the Pharaoh, really. And, you know, his brothers came along, famine going on in the land, and they came to get some food, some corn and some other stuff, oil and whatever else they would have gotten. And Joseph recognized them and said, hey, them is my brothers, man. And look at little Benjamin, who I never really saw. And, I saw him as a little youth. And, you know, the fool works. He's very, very brother too, unlike the others. And, you know, he cried, but he kind of was stern with them and kind of roughed them up a little bit. They didn't know it was him. So anyway, they were set now because they came and they sat with him and he still treated them sort of okay. But he was playing around with them to some degree. And according to the story, they were leaving, going back to their father, Jacob. And this is before they came into the land, obviously, as the full 70 or 72 souls. And they gave them some sacks of corn and said, well, listen, this is for y'all. And I think they gave them some money too. Yeah, something of the sort, and they go forward. But anyway, so he had his cup. This is Joseph now. He had his cup put in the bag of Benjamin. I think it was cup and money, you know. But anyway, let's just stick to the cup. He had his cup, and you know, there's no shame in being a little rusty in that scripture, you know. Yeah, at least not for me. Yeah. He had his cup, his special cup, that he placed inside of the bag of corn for his little brother Benjamin, unknowing to Benjamin and his other brothers. And he told his soldiers, hey, listen, when they reach a certain distance out, you go and rush them and tell them, well, listen, we lose certain things and y'all were amongst us, so we come to check you. Open the bag. All right. You with me, family? Right. Let me start from the top. And he commanded the steward of his house, saying, fill the men's sack with food, as much as they can carry, and put every man's money in his sack's mouth. Okay, you know, they're getting money too. And put my cup, my silver cup, the silver cup in the sack's mouth of the youngest, and his corn money. And he did according to the word that Joseph had spoken. Yeah, he said, the boss says, I'll do that. As soon as the morning was light, the men were sent away, they and their asses. And when they were gone out of the city, and not yet far off, Joseph said unto his steward, up, follow after the men. And when thou doest overtake them, say unto them, wherefore have ye rewarded evil for good? Question. Is not this it in which my Lord drinketh? He telling the man what to tell the man. Is not this in which my Lord drinketh? You're gone with his favorite cup. Oh my. And whereby indeed he divineth? We do. He divineth. Divineth. Let me read that again. Is not this in which, is right? Wait, hold on. Is not this in which my Lord drinketh, whereby and whereby indeed he divineth? Okay, you know, divineth me to call spirits. Okay. Ye have done evil in so doing. Oh. And he overtook them, and he spake unto them these same words. So he overtake them and showed them, well, the same thing. And they said unto him, wherefore said my Lord these words? God forbid that thy servant should do according to this thing. What wrong with you? Behold, the money which we found in our sacks' mouths, we brought again unto thee out of the land of Canaan. How then should we steal out of thy Lord's house silver or gold? So they're showing them like, hey man, we have been in a, you know what I mean, upright with you before. So straightforward. I mean, why you expect us to be going on like that now? With whomsoever of thy servants it be found, both let him die, and we also will be my Lord's bondsmen. So they were so sure that nobody have that, that they're willing to say, well, whoever have it, kill him, and we're going to stay with you. And they know that would break Jacob's heart, but they, it's all right, because nobody can have that. And he said, now also let it be according unto your words. He with whom it is found shall be my servant, and ye shall be blameless. Then they speedily took down every man his sack to the ground and opened every man his sack. And he searched and began at the eldest and left at the youngest, and the cup was found in Benjamin's sack. Then they rent their clothes and laid every man his ass and returned to the city. I could imagine how sad. And Judah and his brethren came to Joseph's house, for he was yet there, and they fell before him on the ground. And Joseph said unto them, what deed is this that ye have done? Wot ye not that such a man as I can certainly divine? I wouldn't go anymore. Now, again, to divine means to call spirits. That's what it means. We've been speaking for a while, I agree. But what have we been saying? We started by breaking down the importance of allegory. And I think we clearly brushed aside all of this years of misconception of even the Bible, King James or whoever. The concept of the animal sacrifice may have been distorted somewhere along the line, even in the same book and its storyline. But the origin of understanding of the written allegory is not that at all. And I think we clarified that too. So here we are, showing the symbol again of the cup. This cup is a cup that he used to divine. This is a cup that he used to call spirits. I mean, that's why we were speaking about the ayahuasca, the magic mushroom. This isn't a let's get high business. This is a very spiritual thing going on when you partake of the tree of life. That is why we dropped the history of the cannabis to give you an understanding of the rich history it has amongst all cultures and how it's respected amongst all peoples, buried with kings and emperors and priests and gods, really.
and its ability to assist in interdimensional travel. Real thing we talking about, the psychedelic king, the tree of life. So in this cup, this chalice cup is divine, we divine it. We call in spirits. Now I know they call rum spirits for obvious reason, because you're really divine in there too. You're provoking and poltergeising and some other things with that. That's the thing that's going on there, and it needs some exorcism and yeah, after that. But for sure, this is a spiritual. Remember, he came down with the yogi book. So now when we look into this writing here, we're looking at the mysteries the mysteries of Melchizedek, really. This is from the sign and the seals, a quest for the lost Ark of the Covenant, and an Ethiopian connection, reading from that section there. Let me just find this here. I just want to read it quickly. Okay, I think this is it here. I don't want to read too much. Basically, what it is, there's a cathedral. I think the cathedral was created or designed by a Charles de Baulle. But it's the Cathedral of Chartres. And at this cathedral, you have specific statues of some of the different, okay, here it is, patriarchs, Moses, etc. I think Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And you also have Melchizedek. He therefore began by asking me why I had suddenly taken an interest in medieval French cathedrals. I replied by outlining my theory that the sculptures I had seen in the north porch of Chartres might in some way have been influenced by the Quebra Negras. Melchizedek with his cup could represent Old Testament Israel, I concluded. He was priest king of Salem, after all, which a number of scholars have identified with Jerusalem. Then the Queen of Sheba with her African servant could represent Ethiopia. Okay, what if I'm a little bit too high up? Don't go away, my people. This point is so key, but I just don't want to be reading too much. Okay, no, let me come down a bit here. That's what one of my guidebook. Oh no, where am I? Oh my, I'm so sorry. Good. Melchizedek is there for the very reason. I know I'm jumping, but it's just one main point I'm trying to get, by the way. He's specifically identified with Christ in the book of Hebrews. He's shown holding a cup. Okay, good. That's the point I want to make. There are other good points here, but that's not the discussion tonight. He's shown holding a cup with the sculpture, and there is also some kind of cylindrical object in the cup, probably meant to represent bread, the bread and wine of the Eucharist. Oh, that's it too, Eucharist, Eucharist, eh? Eucharist, Eucharist, when you partake, Eucharist, Eucharist. That's what one of my guidebooks say. That's what a guidebook say. But there's another one which identifies the cup with the Holy Grail and which argues that the cylindrical object is a stone. Now, we're really coming to a conclusion here. Moses, all these man is ganja man. Moses, Moses. Remember, Moses speak to God in a burning bush. Eh? Moses speak to God in a burning bush. They say when Moses, M-O-S-E-S, that's how it's divided. They say when he come out of the mountain, his eyes were so red that people couldn't even look at his face.
So this is the cup again. This is the cup Joseph used to divide it. See this stone here? This is called the gritty. You take the gritty and you put it inside of the cup. Everyone that burn a chalice understand that science there. Anyone in the world. Now you see the Chartres Cathedral in France. That's a Masonic cathedral, eh? As most of them are, of the Gothic style of building. That's built by high Masons who understand the science. Melchizedek has a cup. Not one of these. The regular Holy Grail looking cup. A chalice, as they would call it. Melchizedek has one in his hand. The king priest Melchizedek. And interesting, remember it's a sculpture, you know, a sculpture. So the artist which would have done this would have been given the instructions exactly what to do. And inside of Melchizedek's cup, there is a little stone. I just read it for you. Look it right there. There is a little stone. It right there. Not a stone you can take out, you know. The stone is a part of the sculptor. The sculpture, pardon me. It's a part of the whole makeup of the statue then. So it was purposely designed that inside of the cup is a little stone. Now let me ask you, why would you want a stone in a cup? And it's not just a cup, it's the Holy Grail. What is the Holy Grail? The Holy Grail is the chalice that Christ and his disciples were using at the Last Supper. Melchizedek, the Christ figure, has the Holy Grail in his hand, according to those that designed it. And his Holy Grail has a little stone inside. We're telling you that the Holy Grail, this is why it had the blood and the body, which is the wine and the bread. Because when you sacrifice the plant on the altar, remember the plant, the green man, the green God represents the tree of life. The plant represents the man, the tree of life. But the plant in its own self is the tree of life. The plant can stand on its own and defend its own self. I'm talking about cannabis as the tree of life. So when you cut up that psychedelical God and put that on the altar and you sacrifice it, what happens? The smoke goes down into the water and plays with the water and comes out as clouds because it is not smoke anymore when it goes through the water. It is now clouds. And when these clouds emerge and come through the nostrils and everything, by the time you done burn the chalice, the water is green. The clear, crisp water that you put inside the chalice is now green. Why is it green? Because it's the chlorophyll of the plant. It's what? The chlorophyll of the plant that made it green. What? The chlorophyll, the blood of the plant, the blood of the plant. The blood of the plant, not the blood of the lamb. The blood of the lamb's bread. The lamb's bread's blood is in the bottom of this basin here, or in the basin, because in Leviticus, it says that there's a basin underneath the altar. The altar, the tophet, Isaiah again 30, the tophet is deep and wide and filled with wood and much fire. The tophet, the same tophet that the Lord shall kindle with his breath, like a stream of brimstone. Talk to me. The same grounded staff, the pipe that the man run up in the mountain with, right there in your Bible. Remember, the Lord gonna circumcise your heart, you know, so check yourself and watch your conversation. You understand? So the green water is the blood of the plant. So this is why the elements are very important. You should not be partaking of the marijuana without water. Because this is not recreation, it's recreation. The marijuana, the cannabis sativa, was created for the communication with the Most High. That's really what it was made for. That is why the Christ himself said, when you do it, as often as you eat and drink, do it in remembrance of me. Now, I'm not speaking on a medical level here. I'm speaking on a spiritual and a theological level. I would say put away with that animal sacrifice concept. It's not no old concept. It's a new concept, because that was not the concept of those who initiated those allegorical words. That's straight up. They were speaking of the risen lamb. They were speaking of the ox. Yeah, because the ox come amongst us too. It's not just the lamb alone. Yeah, it's not the lamb alone coming. The ox, they used to sacrifice ox in the Old Testament. So ox came too. Man, you're not checking the thing. You think it's just a lamb come, an ox come, a lamb come, a he-goat come. Yeah, all the ram come too. All these different animals that were sacrificed came as human beings. It's a serious thing. So the science of the sacrifice of the animal also has to do with killing the animal nature within yourself, killing the beastly nature within yourself, putting the animal nature and the craving and all of that, putting it on the altar and sacrificing it. That is why even the Lenten period has a lot to do with that as well. You know, that beastly part of you, because we are beasts, eh? Animals in a sense, you know what I mean? Heart and lungs, and have to breathe and go to sleep and have to go and use the restroom and the full works and reproduce. It's a different thing. We're not just spiritual. We're biological then, if you don't want to use the term beast. Eh? For real, some people would say we're the intelligent animals. So you must be able to balance that animalistic aspect. And how that is done? To sacrifice the animal. Yeah, sacrifice the beast. So onions, my brothers and sisters, different layers that we are dealing with this. Let me look to bring you down here. So, this is Shishat. I can't just run away here, man. That is Shishat. Shishat specifically, that's a ganja plant leaf above her head there. And she is the wife of Thoth.
Tahuti.
Which is known as Tahuti or Jehuti. Now, Thoth now is your thought. Because he's the god of wisdom. As you could see, he's writing. He's the god of writing. She is the librarian as such. She somewhat holds the Akashic records. She keeps the records of Tahuti. What a wonderful team. And you can see, you know, Tahuti is the wisdom. This is very serious. And all of this has to do with your upper chambers of your mind, you know. Oh, wow. Well, you come there too quick, brother. All this have to do with the upper chambers of your mind. You must be cracking up there. This has to do with the upper chambers of your mind. Because Tahuti, again, your thought. You check it, your thought. That's where the name comes from, your thought. And he's the god of wisdom, your thought, the ibis bird, your thought. You understand? The ibis. And now, Shinau, which is Shisha, she is the storer. She's like the archives for such information, you see. And above her is that cannabis. So you could see, to unlock the powers of Tahuti, and the cannabis would bring you to Shisha, who would express all of the information to you. This is real stuff. And that is why he's taught, that is why he is Tahuti, and he's the ibis. Now, this fella here, really, what we were saying about him is that there's a lot of subliminal messages here too. Because many times you will see Popeye eating the spinach out of a can. You understand? Cannabis, can ibis. Remember, the ibis bird is the thought. The Tahuti is the thought, the wisdom which is released by Shishat. Don't play around. This ain't no joke. Don't play around. This ain't no joke. The name Mary Jane ain't no joke. To that Spider-Man's wife, Mary Jane.
You think it's a joke, everything. And spy and spider has a lot to do with the marijuana. That's why it's a spiral ritual. You call it spiritual, but it's a spiral ritual. When you burn the herb, it comes out in a spiral, deep, deep stuff. So even within the name, it is decoded. The Ganja is the Ganges River. Real thing, you understand. And weed is just to discriminate against it. But the marijuana, the as some say, the prostitute from Mexico, that in itself is a whole story and has a whole science. Because Mary Magdalene, they say, was a prostitute too. And she's the Mary Jane, Mary Magdalene, the marijuana. Science, eh? The what's her name? The Maria, you know, which represents the water. So you come back to the water, the marine, come back to the water again at the same time. You know, the Miriam, Moses' sister that split the water, that walked through Moses, that split the water. It was Miriam that led the sisters through the Red Sea. Miriam led the sisters through the Red Sea. So it's the Red Sea too. You see the color of the sea? It's the Red Sea, symbolic of, again, of the blood. But the red is green here. All of that is taking place here. You know, this represents the womb. This represents new life. This represents creation. All of that is happening here. It represents the Christ going into the underworld and coming out as the new being. So many things is represented even in the chalice. So the can ibis, when Popeye busses spinach, sometimes you see him suck it through the pipe. This is the ganja. It's the marijuana. And he himself, if you notice, he has one eye. Pop eye, father eye on the eye, pop out too. One eye. Even Christ says, better you have one eye. They talk of the one eye of the pyramid. If you notice, he has his ankh on his hand. Yeah, no, it's an ankh, but it's still an ankh on his hand. Spinach. Do you know there's so many other things that we could say, but holy Manuel, I.
So nice,
so give thanks. And I would just say in conclusion, this is why for sure, almost 2 decades now, we don't smoke no spliff. Even if you have to make something for the moment to make sure that we communicate with the water, because there were two elements there. It was the wine and the bread. Very, very important. It's not just the bread alone. That's why the chalice was at the Last Supper. And the chalice represents the living altar of daily sacrifice from the Old Testament. You sacrifice a lamb in the morning. You sacrifice a lamb, the best one too, in the evening, in remembrance of him. Yeah, it never changed. People just confuse it to something else, but it never changed. So we pick up this tradition again. And as you could see, maybe if I just told you this, you would have disbelieved. Some people still don't agree. But if you notice something, we have proven our point clearly. I know I take time to do it, but it's my program, eh? Not like if I and somebody program and they're saying, all right, I have to take some questions now. No, this is my program, yeah. So if I want to go 5 more hours, it's you. If you want to listen or not, I ain't going to force you. But at least I took what I consider time. And there's more I could go into, to be honest, to break it down on another level, but it's just time to stop. But I know for sure we have clarified, you know, without a doubt, where the chalice really stands even within the biblical scripture. You know? So, and the importance of it, this is why it's such a sacred and holy thing. The Eucharist, you know what I mean? Real communication, something to be had in high reverence. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah. So you need the water, man. Okay, it's the body and the blood. That's a key thing. You need to turn the water into wine. Yeah, that's really what it is. The water turned into wine, the chlorophyll of the green God that you put here. Sacrifice the lamb, the same lamb's bread, the green God. Water becomes green, it's the blood, it's the, yeah, the water turned to wine, it's a full science. And then you throw it out on the earth in libation form. That's the real libation, but again, the time, because I could give you a nice rendition of that one from the Bible with David. Eh? Holy Emmanuel, I Selassie, I Rastafari. So, definitely looking forward to seeing you for the spring equinox. Just contact us, you know what to do. PriestIsaac27@gmail.com. And for those who are still checking for their chalice, I would believe by now you should be saying, well, yeah, man, without a doubt, I think that is the way to go. And just contact us. I must say it will be an investment, especially. So I'm not saying this to ward no one off, but that's just what it is in the world. We don't have no shipping company, and trust me, just make up your mind to make an investment, especially, our price is quite nominal, really, but as far as shipping and handling, which we profit nothing from, make up your mind to make an investment. So give thanks to the life giver and the keeper of life, but don't worry, man, it's a blessing. It's a blessing. You will get blessed, brother. That's how it is. We're talking about. Yeah, that's the fire I live. You see what we just talked about, the importance of how you come before the Father and remember him. So that's why when you partake and you watch certain things, you go certain places. If your meditation is strong enough after you done meditate, you read certain books, even like the autobiography and all of these different things. Yeah, man. It sparks differently in your heavens as you deal with the Most High. Give thanks, man, for Haile Selassie first, ever living God, Black Christ in flesh, you know, in resurrection time at hand. Give thanks for such. Yes, I. Holy Emmanuel, I. Selassie, I. Jah, Rastafari. Give thanks, family. Yes, I love.